are thirsty, come to the water.
Conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us.
Literally waking up one day, and it didn't seem to bother me anymore, and I was just fine. When I was ordained about 9 years, I was at St. Rita Parish then in West Dallas. That was where the four of us priests were then. And it was really good. It was a great parish, this huge place, a lot of great things going on. But I don't know, something within me was saying, is this where you should be? Is this the kind of work you should be involved in? Should you stay in the priesthood? These kinds of things. Now, I was in an environment, I thought, which was really very good. Why was I having these kind of questions going on in my own mind? Now, you would think that I would approach the other priests and talk about what was going on in my own heart, mind, and soul. Did I? No. It was finally when I talked to some of the lay people in the parish, folks that I got to know pretty well, that I just started talking about this kind of stuff. And I think typically what people will say, oh, it's gonna be okay. And that's pretty much what they told me. Oh, it's gonna be okay. And I don't know, if within a relatively short time, it was okay. And I wasn't plagued by this stuff until I was ordained about 14, 15 years, and I was going through this kind of thing again. And did I have something to offer? Is this where I should be? The first thing I did, crazy as this may sound, my checking account, the name on it, I had Reverend Peter C. Drenzik. So I went to the bank one day and I said, I want you to take the Reverend off of my checking account. I thought this was a stepping stone to leaving the priesthood. Now, did I go talk to anybody? No. You know, men, we heal ourselves. We don't need this outside stuff. Anyway, I don't know what it was. Something just happened. Literally waking up one day, and it didn't seem to bother me anymore, and I was just fine. As I look back at it now over the years, I'm thinking that maybe I was trying too hard to nourish other people. I wasn't allowing people to nourish me along the way. So I was kind of spending myself and the stuff I was doing and somehow not even replenishing it. Then you might even wonder, where was God in all of this? And I might even wonder, rather than trying to do it myself, I should have been reaching out where I should have been reaching to most of all through prayer and scripture. And somehow it's as I was going through the phases and the steps of all of this, it somehow just wasn't registering in a timely fashion. But it seemed to work out okay. And now I'm in my 70s and I say, it's fine. I don't seem to be plagued by any of those doubts or questions anymore. Maybe it just took a little time to realize that the nourishment I was receiving was real and it was helping me, and I was just sort of taking it for granted. And I don't know if any of us can do that. So I'm not self-sufficient. I need nurturing, just like everybody else, in order for me then to be able to be one who could help to nurture other people. So what is it that you and I have to give? This amazing story of the gospel, I wonder if it's talking about Jesus hearing of the death of John the Baptist, maybe was troubling to him. Maybe that's why he said, I just got to get away from here for a while. What was he going through in his own mind? I have no idea. But projecting from my life, I'm wondering if Jesus said, I don't know if I can take this anymore. This is getting a little deeper, more profound, and more difficult than I ever anticipated. Maybe I should just back off from the whole thing and call it quits and just live my life the way I want to. I don't know if that was in Jesus' mind, but it makes sense to me that it might, learning of this thing and is going on in his life. If this is what happened to John the Baptist, Don't you think Jesus realized, this is probably going to happen to me? Do I want this to happen to me? Can we hide from it? Probably not. We may try to do all sorts of other diversions, but it's going to keep bothering us until we are really true to ourselves. So what came to my own mind in thinking about this was Jesus needed nurturing, which is maybe why he had to get away from it all for a while. But look what happens. According to the scripture, people kept going to find him. And maybe that was the opportunity for the others to nurture Jesus for a time. I hope this doesn't sound heretical. It's just thinking aloud. Because if Jesus was truly human like us in all things, some of the emotion and the things that go on in the life of a human being could have easily taken place in Jesus' life too. He overcame it. And the folks who came to him, sure, they were asking for things, but Jesus was refreshed apparently by all of this, nurtured by all of this, so that he was once again able to be very much the leader of the group. And they were faced with an issue now. Okay, Jesus, picture him feeling much better. And it's getting late in the day, and the disciples, you know, we all get hungry. Maybe you're hungry right now, and I can't help you at the moment, I guess. And they say, Jesus, let's get out of here, go and get something to eat, and let them go and find their own stuff. Isn't it amazing how Jesus puts that? You feed them. What have we got? A couple of loaves of bread and a couple of fish? Come on, it's barely enough to feed us, let alone all of these people. A teaching moment, an extraordinary moment. Jesus says, you know, settle down. We'll take care of this. So we have to pay attention to the example of Jesus, that he can take what seems to be so little and can manufacture an opportunity to feed the multitude. I think that's what I was going through. Was I sufficient? Did I have enough knowledge? Did I have enough experience in my own life to be able to do what I should be doing? And when we realize that we are not self-sufficient, that we don't have all of the answers, we reach deeper down inside of ourselves and find we can provide much, much more than we ever thought we could. When someone is approached, you know, through the years, when I'd say, we need someone to do, you know, and people who sit closer in church, they're likely to be the suspects you pull into things. You see them more. That's why our churches are built with shorter aisles, so we can be closer together. That's really important. But we would tap people, right? Maybe you have been some of those victims of the clergy or other staff in the parish to say, you could do this. Now, many people are real gracious and they say, okay. Sometimes you may have to say, think about this for a minute. What I'd like you to do is, and then you go home with this in your mind. And I'm hoping that none of us ever, upon request, immediately says, me? No, there's no way I could do that, and just walk away from it. Then I don't know if we're tapping our resources. If we are allowing the nurturing that's coming to us to be effective. The scriptures have an awful lot of occasions where people are first being fed. Talks about food so much. Jesus goes to so many meals, you'd think he'd weigh 300 pounds. Eating and drinking is so very normal part of life. We have to do it. And in so many cases, first you have to feed the body. The mind, the heart, and the soul will follow. But first, we have to have this physical sense of well-being in order for the rest of it also to work well. And so it's no surprise that before Jesus could teach this group of people, the real hardcore message that he had to deliver is they had to be physically satisfied, nourished. So feed them. Do we do it today? Of course we do. And after communion, there'll be an invitation for that, specifically for this parish. But Anytime you might just offer a smile to someone might be an incredible piece of nourishment that you give to someone else. You know, just holding the door for someone. All of these things seem so trite and almost meaningless, but they're very fulfilling at that given moment in time. The things we can do for others, sky's the limit. We don't have to be holding, you know, PhDs, and we don't have to have these incredible jobs and front page newspaper articles about ourselves. Just living day by day with a sense of gratitude for how we are nourished by so many people and by the hand of God in this unique meal that we have here, for which there is no price. We just come forward and we receive it gratefully from God. No matter our status, no matter what social climate we're in, and all of that stuff, irrelevant. We will be fed by the hand of God through Jesus, who gives to us the opportunities to feed and nurture others. It's an amazing thing, this socialization process we live in. We need each other desperately for nourishment of mind, body, spirit, the whole person. And Jesus gives us the way and shows us the way. Provide for others. That's what you and I have to do. And the more we do it, the more we are nurtured and satisfied. It works. It really works. I'm confident that many of us know this already. And I'm grateful to be able to think about it for myself, to remind me that I have to be one who nurtures others. Sure, I'm a retired priest. Did I dump it all? No. I'm more convinced now than ever of what I'm able and should be doing. I'm not ready to jump back full-time in a parish. No. But that's something I've learned, I guess. But it's wonderful to be able to come and just walk among people. And be nourished as you nourish me by your being here this morning. Thank you.